Maxwell House Coffee presents The News of 1940. The makers of Maxwell House Coffee welcome you once again to an hour of entertainment brought to you each week from Hollywood, and starring Fanny Bryce, Hanley Stafford, Connie Boswell, and Meredith Wilson and his orchestra. Tonight's guests of honor are Walter Houston and one of the screen's foremost character comedians, Raymond Walburn. And here is your host for this hour of entertainment, Edward Arnold.
Good evening, everybody. I think we've got another grand show for you tonight. Our old friend Walter Houston and that amusing fellow Raymond Walburn. And to start our program, Meredith Wilson has arranged a special opening number with some sort of seasonal flavor. What's the name of it, Meredith?
Winter Wonderland. Say, Eddie, I certainly enjoyed that Thanksgiving turkey at your house today, but I'd like to make a suggestion.
Later. Ladies and gentlemen, Meredith Wilson plays Winter Underwear.
Wonderland.
Okay, play it. Continue with the good news program.
Pardon. Huh? I enjoyed that party at your house, Eddie, but I'd like to make just one little criticism.
Something the matter with the turkey?
No, the turkey was fine, what there was of it.
What?
And there was plenty of it, such as it was. As a matter of fact, even if it was no good, I wouldn't complain about it. I'm too well bred.
Yes, I can see that. But what is it that's rankling on your breast?
Oh, that's gravy. But if I thought you wouldn't take offense, I'd like to make just one suggestion.
Well, I'd be glad to have a suggestion. Go ahead.
All right. It was in regards to, you're sure you won't mind?
Certainly not, old fellow. Go on.
Well, just about the time that dinner was over, you know, Eddie, I think the reason I'm hesitating over this is that I have a cousin who's a fat lug, too, and he's very touchy.
And do you ever give him suggestions?
All the time. But I want to be sure you'll take what I'm going to say in the right spirit.
Oh, absolutely.
Well, what I was thinking was that at your party, right after the, Listen, Eddie, you're sure I won't hurt your feelings.
Come on, what is it?
All right, you asked for it. I don't think it was right for you to have those collie dogs of yours in the dining room while we were eating dinner.
Well, I must say, that's a very silly criticism. I have those dogs in the dining room with me every evening. Well, they're extremely well-mannered.
Well, maybe so. But it was awfully annoying to have them sitting there for half an hour licking my fingers.
Well, if you'd eat with a knife and a fork, you wouldn't be so friendly.
Oh. I knew you'd lose your temper. I'll never make another suggestion to you again.
Now you're cooking with gas. All right, we'll go ahead with the program. Ladies and gentlemen, our guests of honor this evening are Walter Houston.
Oh, I like him.
Good. And that amiable gentleman of the screen, Raymond Walburn.
Well, that's a relief.
What do you mean, a relief?
I was afraid you were going to have that uncouth Rosenblum again.
Well, what's the matter with him? I think he's very amusing, and so does the public.
Amusing nothing. He's a dope. Well, he's no actor. The guy is punch drunk.
Well, Murdoch, he's been in 400 fights. What's your excuse?
Connie, you took the words right out of my mouth.
I couldn't hold back any longer, Eddie.
Well, I'm sure I don't see what's so funny.
Well, I don't care, Meredith. I really don't. But after that remark, I think you'd better crawl up on that stand.
Okay.
Miss Boswell, will you favor us with a song?
I sure will, Eddie. And I'd like to say I enjoyed your party. With no ifs, ands, or buts.
Oh, what a girl. What a girl. Ladies and gentlemen, Connie Boswell sings one of the brightest of the new songs, Scatterbrain.
You're as pleasant as the morning and refreshing as the rain. Isn't it a pity that you're such a scatterbrain? When you dance, it's so delightful. When you talk, it's so insane. Still, it's charming, chatter, scatterbrain. I know I'll end up apoplectic, but there's nothing I can do. It's just the same as being in a hurricane. And though my life will be too hectic, I am so in love with you. Nothing else will matter, you're my darling scatterbrain. You're as sweet as sugar cane. What a shame, what a shame that you're a scat, scat, scatterbrain. When we dance, I think it's heaven, till about the third refrain. What a shame, what a shame that you're a scatterbrain. I'm up that well-known tree. I've tried to understand your double talk in vain. Oh, please forgive your critic, 'cause you mean so much to me. Nothing else can matter, my scatterbrain. What a shame that you're a scat, scat, scatterbrain.
And here's Warren Hull, all ready to set the next scene.
Thanks, Eddie. The scene is just outside the football stadium nearest your town and mine. It's just a few minutes before game time. The sky is gray. There's a real chill in the air. But say, I've never seen so many smiling faces. As we join the huddle of happy young people to our right, we hear...
Say, Judy, pass that thermos of coffee over this way, will you please?
Right, Bob. But go easy on us. We'll be frozen before the game is over unless we save some coffee for the half.
Okay, Judy. But say, next time, let's bring more coffee. Football and Maxwell House coffee mean a big afternoon in any man's language.
Yes, whether it's on the campus or in the kitchen, there's nothing like the cheery stimulation and friendly warmth of a steaming, fragrant cup of Maxwell House coffee to set a man right with the world. You see, ever since it was created more than 50 years ago by a man named Joel Cheek, this famous coffee has been a favorite with thousands of men the country over. First, because we found a way to further enrich this famous coffee blend so wonderfully that now you get extra goodness, extra body and richness, flavor you may never have known in coffee before. Second, there's the new radiant roast process, which roasts each coffee bean evenly all the way through. No chance this way of weak coffee from under-roasting or bitter coffee from parched coffee beans. And that's why today more people are enjoying Maxwell House than ever before in its history. So if you haven't tried Maxwell House coffee lately, get upon tomorrow, won't you? We think your own enjoyment and satisfaction
will tell you this new Maxwell House is now, more than ever, good to the last drop.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, here's Fanny Bryce as Baby Snooks. Well, it had to happen sooner or later. Daddy, played by Hanley Stafford, has received a jury summons and must appear in court today. To make matters worse, this is Daddy's busy day at the office. And as the scene opens, we find him dressing hurriedly and in a none too pleasant mood. Listen.
Fine thing. 5 million people in this city and they have to pick me for jury duty. I'll give the guy life.
Good morning, Daddy.
What's good about it?
Huh?
Nothing. Look out, Snooks. I'm in a hurry.
Where are you going?
I have to be in court in half an hour. Where's my pants?
You got them on.
Oh, well, never mind. I'll look for them myself.
Where are you going, Daddy?
I told you, I have to go to court.
Why?
I've been called for jury duty. I've got to appear in a suit.
What kind of suit?
They didn't tell me. It can be any kind of a suit.
You want to wear my Mickey Mouse suit?
Snooks, this has nothing to do with clothes. Someone is suing somebody else.
Why?
I don't know. I'll find out when I get there.
Why do you have to go, Daddy?
Because I'm going to be a member of the jury.
I want to join, too.
Now, don't start any of that nonsense. In the first place, little girls don't serve on juries.
Why?
Because that's the law. A jury is composed of 11 jurors and a foreman.
What for?
He gives the verdict. All juries must have foremen.
You said they had 11.
They have got 11, but they have foremen besides.
They have 15 men?
No, they only have 12.
Huh?
Yes, there's 11 men on juries, and with the foremen makes it 12.
11 and 4 is 12?
No, 11 and 4 is 15. But the foreman in this case happens to be just one man, and he's the foreman. Sometimes the jury has 12 jurymen, and they're all ladies.
The foreman, too?
Exactly.
Do you feel all right, Daddy?
Listen, Snooks, it doesn't make any difference how I feel. I still have to go to court and serve on that broken-down jury. Understand?
Understand. What's a jury?
What did I just get through telling you?
11 and 4 is 12, and all the men is ladies. That's what you told me.
I didn't say anything of the kind! If they were all ladies on the jury, what would I be doing there?
I know.
Now, you stop that. Getting more like your mother every day. Now, let me finish dressing.
I want to go with you, Daddy.
You can't go with me. They don't allow children in court.
Why?
Because it's a very serious thing. The only people present are the lawyers, the judge, and jury. We have to decide whether the man is innocent or guilty.
Which man?
The man that's being tried.
What's he trying to do, Daddy?
He's trying to get free. Today, he gets his hearing.
Is he deaf? Is he a deaf man?
No, he's not deaf.
You don't have to yell. I ain't deaf either.
Well, then, don't bother me with questions.
Why?
Because I'm in a hurry. If I don't get to court on time, they'll hold me in contempt.
Where's that?
It's no place. It's a breach of the law, and I'll get a fine.
Get what?
Fine.
You like it, Daddy?
No, I hate it. But I have to go just the same. When people are called for jury duty, they have to go because they receive subpoenas.
I want some peanuts, too.
I didn't say some peanuts. I said some peanuts. Subpoenas.
Well, what do you have to do there?
Well, as soon as I get to court, I'm challenged by both lawyers.
I want to see you fight them.
I don't fight them. They interrogate me.
Does it hurt?
No, it doesn't hurt. It simply means the lawyers ask me a lot of questions before they swear me in.
Huh?
I have to swear.
Do you make the lawyers mad, Daddy?
Nobody makes me mad!
Well, why do you have to swear at them?
I don't swear at the lawyers. I take an oath that I'll see justice served properly. Then the court is called to order. The lawyers come in with their briefs.
Is that all they wear?
They don't wear their briefs. They hand them to the judge.
Ain't he got any of his own?
Why, no. The only briefs he's got are those he gets from the lawyers. And you know what he does?
He puts them on.
Snooks, these are not the kind of briefs people wear. These briefs are just paper.
Mommy's got snow.
I don't care what Mommy's got. Now, these papers contain the evidence in the case. That's how the lawyers present the bare facts. Is everything clear to you now?
Uh-huh. Nobody wears socks
body is fully dressed. The evidence is presented, the witnesses testify, the lawyers argue the case, and then the judge charges the jury.
How much?
He doesn't charge the money. He places the case in the hands of the jury. We weigh the testimony and bring in the verdicts.
I want to go see you do it.
No, and I've got to leave right now.
Oh, take me with you, all.
You'll what?
I'll shake my head till my head falls off.
Oh, please, Snooks, don't make any trouble now. I'll be late for court.
Take me with you, Doug.
No. Now, look here. I'll show you what happens there. Satisfied?
Satisfied.
All right. You'll be the defendant, and I'll be your lawyer. Now, you take the stand.
Where shall I take it, Daddy?
Nowhere. Just sit in that chair and hurry. Now, you were charged with stealing some cookies from the kitchen.
Am I?
Yes. First, I have to swear you in. Repeat after me. I solemnly swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, so help me.
I solemnly swear to smell the fruit, the whole fruit.
Never mind. I'll just examine you.
Shall I stick up my tongue?
No. No. I'm going to prove that you didn't take those cookies from that cookie jar.
You can't do it.
Why not?
Because I took them.
Well, that's fine. You're convicted. Then stay dressed. Goodbye.
Goodbye. Yeah!
Well, ladies and gentlemen, Meredith Wilson's next number is so good, I've got to break down and apologize for losing my temper with him a few moments ago. Meredith, I am truly sorry.
Okay, Ed. Possibly I was at fault.
Don't let's go into that. But honestly, here's another one of these arrangements in the South American rhythm that really does something to me. This time, it's The Moon Was Yellow. And ladies and gentlemen, it's marvelous. One of the most amusing and versatile comedians and character actors in Hollywood. On the screen, you know Raymond Walburn as a conniving gentleman with a blustering manner and a roving eye for the fair sex. Off the screen, he is quiet, reserved, and almost monkish in his habits. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you the other side of Raymond Walburn, better known as the Deacon. All right, Raymond, come on out and say hello to the people. I'm afraid we've got the wrong side of Walburn. He's coming on here with three very lovely girls.
Now, Eddie, don't get me wrong. You know, these pretty little flowers are my nieces, the daughters of my only sister who resides in Denver.
Well, that's all right.
They have attended exclusive finishing schools in the East, but every winter they come out here to spend a little time with their old Uncle Raymond. You know, they're lovely, well-bred girls.
Yes, I'm sure of that.
Now, girls, I'll have to find some seats for you. How about those seats in the front row, or would you rather sit on the stage?
I don't really.
We'll sit on the stage, mister.
Your nieces.
Oh, yeah. They're very formal children, Eddie. An old Chicago family.
I thought you said Denver.
Oh, I did say Denver. You're quite right, Edward. But I might just as well have said Schenectady.
Why?
My sister's third husband was a gypsy. Yeah. They're beautiful children, aren't they? Yeah,
I should say so. Why, they could be in Earl Carroll's show.
They are, Eddie. They are. Sit down, girl. Sit down, ladies.
Well, Deacon, you've crossed me up. Here I've been trying to show the public your offstage character, and you walk in with a handful of chorus girls. Now, is that cricket?
No, Eddie, but it's more fun. However, Edward, you can put your mind at rest. These delicate creatures are business associates of mine.
Yes?
Yes, they hold responsible positions in one of my holding companies.
Hold on.
I'm holding.
This is most interesting, Deacon. Not many people know this, but I myself am behind a big corporation.
Well, I think everybody knows it, Eddie. I do, really. You know, this particular company of mine is known as Turkey Enterprises Incorporated. My corporation supplies turkeys to our client by subscription.
Oh, well, how does it work?
I let my board of directors give you the standard sales talk. Ladies?
When do we eat?
That's the whole thing in a nutshell. But in order to make it a little clearer, Edward, I'll explain it myself. Now, in the month of March, I receive $400 in subscription money. Then I go out and purchase one turkey by the name of Sylvia for $3.
That's a pretty name.
For a turkey, yes. That leaves me a net profit of $397.
So far.
By careful manipulation and diplomatic treatment, mind you, the turkey is persuaded to lay eggs.
Oh, Sylvia lays eggs.
Yes, yes, at the rate of 5 a day.
Now, Deacon, I don't like that.
Well, the turkey don't like it either. So. Now, by the end of June, I have 400 turkeys and 900 eggs. Now, would you be interested in investing in this enterprise?
Now, listen here, Deacon. Did you come onto this program just to lay in a, to sell turkeys?
I beg your pardon. Certainly not. Certainly not, Eddie. I'm merely trying to let my friends in on a good thing.
Yeah, well, I see. Maybe this will surprise you, Deacon, but I was once a confidence man myself.
That is an ugly term, Edward.
Yes, I know, but as one crook to another, let me tip you off. There's nobody around here dumb enough to put money in your scheme.
Oh, that's very discouraging, Eddie, very discouraging. Now, wait a minute. What about that, that rube over there with the hair?
Huh? You don't say that. That's Meredith Wilson. He's the mental type you're looking for, but I don't know.
I'll bet he carries a change purse. Introduce me to him.
Okay. Oh, Meredith, I want you to meet Mr. Walburn. He's an investment counselor.
Well, Mr. Walburn, it's an honor.
And these ladies here are my board of directors.
Oh, it's a pleasure.
Mr. Wilson, you seem like a man of discernment. Do you know anything about turkeys?
Do I? You might not think it to look at me, but I was raised on a farm.
Well. That just goes to show you can't judge a book by its cover. No. Yeah. So you're familiar with raising turkeys, eh?
I slept with turkeys till I was 9.
Oh, you did?
Yes, sir. My father raised turkeys.
Meredith was the oldest.
Well, I know one thing. You can't make any money with turkeys.
Quite right, my boy. Quite right. Are you married?
In a small way. Don't let that bother you, girls.
We won't.
Well, tell me, Mr. Wilson.
Wilson, two L's. Normandy, 2348. That's my office phone, if anybody's interested.
I'll have to get my hunting license.
Tell me, Mr. Wilson, How are you going to remember your wife this Christmas?
Well, how can I forget her? She'll be right there under the tree.
No. I'm talking about a little gift to gladden her heart. Would you be interested in a fur coat?
Slightly stolen.
What's that?
Nothing. Mr. Williams?
Wilson.
Wilson. I can get you a nice fur coat for Mrs. Williams very reasonably. Finest fur on the market.
Well, will it stand the rain?
Well, did you ever see a skunk carry an umbrella?
No.
I can let you have this coat for, how much money did you say you had?
$300.
$300!
Well, that's lucky, isn't it?
Yes, sir. Could you get to the bank tomorrow morning?
I'm too smart for those banks, Mr. Walburn. I carry the money right with me, pinned to my undershirt.
You say you have $300 on your person at this very moment?
Yes, sir.
I see. How would you like to come over to my house and take a shower?
Wait a minute, Deacon. Chisel it. Don't steal it.
Okay. On second thought, my boy, that fur coat would not be a good investment for you. For $300, I'm going to let you have 300 shares of stock in the Spurious Gold Mine Incorporated. That entitles you to all the privileges.
Well, what does that mean?
That means that you'll be taken into the firm.
Oh, boy. I always say, he who hesitates has lost... Here's the 300, Mr. Walburn.
Thanks. You're a shrewd operator, my boy.
Well, when will you take me in?
You've been taken in already. Ladies, a new addition to our board of directors.
When do we eat?
Right now. See you later, Eddie.
Return in just a moment when you will hear Walter Houston in a stirring drama and the entire cast in a comedy sketch. In the meantime, we pause briefly for station identification.
This is Edward Arnold again, and we continue our Maxwell House Good News program with a tune I first heard Meredith play several weeks before I was even a member of the Good News cast. It's one of the season's hits called 100 to 1. Be sure and listen for the counting in the second chorus. Meredith? Now I'm proud to present to you again one of the most distinguished American actors, our guest of honor, Walter Huston.
Tonight, Walter Huston will play an old part in a new play, a part, curiously enough, that he created years before the play was written, Bright World by Arch Obler. The scene is an orphan's picnic in a public park. The warm air sings with the happy voices of children on a long-awaited holiday, but all the children are not at play. One small boy sits huddled on the grass, far apart from the others. Another small boy approaches him and hesitantly speaks to him.
Oh, Ted, what do you want?
Well, I thought, well, the fellas thought maybe I'd come over and be with us. We're having lots of fun.
I don't want to.
Oh, but, Ted, everybody's having so much fun. Well, the games we're playing, even you could, you could...
Let me alone.
Oh, gosh, Ted, everybody says if you only start laughing again, you'll feel better.
Oh, leave me alone, I said. I don't want to laugh. I don't want nothing.
But, Ted, the games...
I said leave me alone. Go on, beat it.
Okay, Ted, if that's what you want.
Hurry up, Joe. We're waiting for her.
Why don't you want to laugh, boy?
Huh?
I said, why don't you want to laugh?
What's it to you?
Well, I couldn't help overhearing the other boy, and it seems so strange that a boy shouldn't want to laugh.
Let me alone.
But why not talk with me? It's good to talk sometimes with someone strange to you. Now, please tell me, boy, why don't you want to laugh?
Nothing to laugh about anymore.
Why not? The sun still laughs. The water laughs. There's jokes and games and fun. The world is full of laughter if you'll listen.
Not for me, it isn't.
But why?
Why? Why? Because I'm blind, see? Blind. Blind.
I knew that.
Then what'd you have to bother me for?
Tell me, boy, when did it happen?
4th of July.
Independence Day, eh? Ah, it's a strange divinity that shapes our ends.
What'd you say?
It doesn't matter. But what does matter to me is what you've done with all those days since you've closed your eyes.
I sit and wait.
You wait? For what?
For nothing.
Mind if I... talk to you a little longer?
Talking? What good's talking?
I know. Yes, I know. Ever since it happened, the good folks at the parsonage have... they've tried to cheer you up with words. Words are empty, aren't they? When you sit in darkness.
Yeah.
Yet if you listen, perhaps I can tell you words you never heard. Words that will make you want to laugh again.
Tell you I'll never laugh again.
And you think you'll never see again?
Never. They told me never.
And yet you will. You'll see more clearly than you ever saw before.
Oh, see?
Yes. But not with eyes. With heart.
I don't know what you mean.
When boys and men see with their eyes, they just see as far as their eyes can see. A little world of kites and sleds and making money. But mind and heart is far more real. Far more wonderful.
But how? How can I see? It's all so terrible dark.
Now, think of a ship. A great black pirate ship. The sails are white against a sky of blue. Think of it, boy. Think hard.
Yes, I'll try.
The ship is bounding high against green waves that throw it here and there. A great black ship with sails of white. You see it, son. You must see it.
Yes, I see it.
Now, that ship that's there inside your mind is a ship I never saw in life. I read about it in a book when I was just about as old as you are now. And yet I see it. And you see it. Just from words. Yes, far better than if we saw with wide open eyes. Do you understand?
I think I do. Yes, I do.
Ah, that's fine, boy. That's fine. Now you'll have a wonderful world of books, and yet not books, but living things. You'll see them in your mind. They live, they'll breathe, they'll be. No, no, wait, boy. Why do you turn your face away?
But I'll never be able to do anything.
Oh, yes, you will. Yes, you will. You'll find new things to do.
But I can hardly walk. I run into things. I fall. So dark, mister.
Yes, but now that you know the darkness really isn't there. It's just a great white canvas on which to paint the pictures that the words of books and friends will bring you. And if there is no dark, why be afraid, boy? Why be afraid?
I'm not afraid. No, I'm not afraid.
And being unafraid, you'll try to do things, won't you, boy?
Yes. Yes, I will.
Yes, I know you will. You'll never be afraid again, boy. You'll live with goodness and with courage, and you'll make the world a better place because of your life in it.
Will I, mister?
So now you see why you can laugh, boy. For you thought you'd nothing left. And yet you've got the whole world of air and sun and rain to feel. A world of all the great minds left to understand. A world of friends to love and share life with you.
Gee, I've got so much left, haven't I?
So come on, boy, laugh. Lift your face and laugh. The joke's on you. You've got the world. Laugh, I tell you, laugh. It's good to laugh, isn't it?
Yes, it's good to laugh.
Ted, you're laughing. Gee, Ted, you'll be all right now.
Yeah, I'm all right.
But why are you laughing? Why?
Him. Ask him.
Him?
Yeah. He showed me how to laugh again. He did it.
He? Ted, who are you talking about?
This man here. The one that's standing next to me.
Man?
Yes. Here, right next to me.
Gosh, Ted, there's nobody here. Nobody but that statue of Abraham Lincoln.
Yes, it was an old part in a new play, for Walter Houston will be remembered perhaps best of all in the character of Abraham Lincoln.
There's a real reason for honoring Lincoln tonight. A double reason. This is the beginning of Thanksgiving week, and Abraham Lincoln is the father of Thanksgiving. He proclaimed Thanksgiving Day as a national holiday in 1863. But there's another reason, too, for remembering Lincoln at this time. Just 76 years ago this week, on the battlefield of Gettysburg, some great and resounding speeches were made. When they were all done, a tall and lonely man stood up and said a few words that were scarcely heard. Some men today say that he wasn't speaking to the people who stood in the battlefield at Gettysburg, but to us, the living, the Americans that live today, and the Americans that will live always. And as long as his words remain in the hearts of men, there will be democracy and freedom. Words to remember. Four score and 7 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation or any nation so conceived and so dedicated can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We have come to dedicate a portion of that field as a final resting place for those who here gave their lives that that nation might live. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground. The brave men, living and dead, who struggled here, have consecrated it far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will little note, nor long remember what we say here, but it can never forget what they did here. It is for us, the living, rather to be dedicated here to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus far so nobly advanced. It is rather for us to be here dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion. That we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain. That this nation, under God, shall have a new birth of freedom. And that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth.
Now from 1863 back to 1939, Connie Boswell sings one of this season's hit ballads, and it's from the new Rodgers and Hart musical comedy, Too Many Girls, and it's called I Didn't Know What Time It Was.
I didn't know what time it was then I met you. Oh, what a lovely time it was, how sublime it was too. I didn't know what day it was you held my hand, warm like the month of May it was, and I'll say it was then. Grand to be alive, to be young, to be mad, to be yours alone. Grand to see your face, feel your touch, hear your voice say, I'm all your own. I didn't know what year it was. Life was no prize. I wanted love, and here it was, shining out of your eyes. And I know what time it is now.
To be alive, to be young, to be mad, to be yours alone.
Didn't know what year it was. Life was no prize. I wanted love, and here it was, shining out of your eyes. I'm wild, and I know what time it is
And here's Warren Howell, who has introduced many of you to Maxwell House Coffee, with some very sound advice for those who have not yet discovered it.
Thanks, Eddie. Just remember, with Maxwell House, you're getting coffee that's not just days fresh, but roaster fresh. And no coffee can be fresher than that.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, last week we presented a football sketch because football was in the air. Tonight our whole cast will present another one, but it won't be about football. I suppose all of you think we're not going to do a Thanksgiving Day sketch, huh? Because you've heard so many already, but you're wrong. It's entitled, Here Come the Pilgrims. 99 4/400% Puritan. However, it doesn't float.
Does it sink?
Now you're getting warm, Deacon. It's the year 1620. The folks have just got off the Mayflower, and they're milling around on the edge of the American continent.
Well, here we are at last.
We're here.
Yes, indeed, we're really here.
By this time, folks, you know they're here. Now get on with the story.
Daddy!
What is it, Snooks?
What's that big thing over there sticking out of the water?
That's Plymouth Rock.
I want it.
You can't have it.
Why?
That pesky kid will be the death of us yet. Yesterday I caught her boring holes in the Mayflower.
I want that rock.
I'll give it to you later.
Say, do any of you pilgrims know where we are?
This is Massachusetts, brother.
What?
Massachusetts.
It's tonight.
Hey, Daddy. Stop it.
Oh, leave me alone. Go and find a pumpkin pie. It's Thanksgiving.
Look at Daddy. Look at the funny man with feathers. They're barefoot all over.
Good heavens. Indians.
Ah, the Indians are coming. Let's put up the collapsible fort. Come on. Make with that fort. We'll all be scalped.
All finished, Captain Houston.
Ah, we're safe. Those savages will never penetrate this Sears Roebuck fort.
Wait a minute, Captain. What if the Indians blockade the stockade?
Jeepers, I never thought of that.
We already have a shortage of food.
Yes, and there's a shortage of water.
Are all the women safe?
Yep, I'm here.
Holy smoke, we're short of women, too.
Hey, Captain.
Look out. Here comes the lookout.
Warren Hull, the people's choice. I'm supposed to be an Indian, but I couldn't resist it. So long.
The Indians have kidnapped Mr. Stafford's little daughter, Snooks.
Oh, no. We must rescue the child. I'll call for volunteers.
I'll go.
I'll go, too. How about you, Daddy?
I can't understand how Northwestern could lose last Saturday.
Inhuman beast. You won't help rescue your own daughter? Have you no pity?
Only for the Indians. Wait till they've had her for half an hour.
Where's the lookout?
Here.
Here, take a peep, Hull, and tell the people what's in the peephole. Make it snappy, Jack.
I'm peeping, Tom.
Tell us the worst, lookout.
The Indians are coming back, and they're bringing Snooks with them.
That's the worst.
They're waving a flag of truce.
Stafford, you go out there and make a parley.
Okay, Captain. Peace at any price. Mm. Open the door carefully, but as soon as I'm outside, shut it quick.
Hey, what happened to the collapsible fort?
It's collapsed. Shh. Let's listen to the parley.
Hello, Daddy. Look what I brought you. A big fat Indian.
Why, Snooks, let go of that Indian's feathers. He'll scalp you.
No, he won't. He likes me.
Well, I don't know how to talk to this muzzler. Now, what's new, Tonto?
That ain't his name, Daddy.
Oh, excuse me. Do you know his name, Snooks?
Uh-huh.
Are you sure?
Uh-huh.
Well, what is it?
I don't know.
Oh, he's trying to say something, Snooks. What on mine, Chief? We want him only peace.
How?
Why?
Huh? Tonk.
Ah.
Oh, don't argue with him, Snooks. Now, listen, brother. We only came here to start a little subdivision, make a few dollars. Why don't you call off the tribe? We'll all celebrate Thanksgiving.
Oh, Clay, me very friendly.
He's got a turkey, Daddy.
Oh, you have?
Sure, I got turkey. You want him celebrate?
Sure.
You better hurry up or he'll be doing Greek next.
Snooks, we made peace with the Indians and we're going to have a turkey dinner. Call everybody together.
All right. Come on, get your turkey. Sit down, everybody. Oh, good night.
All right, now. Everybody squat down Indian fashion. In honor of Chief Tonto, we're going to divide the turkey in the traditional manner of the Blackfeet tribe.
Give me the Blackfoot, Daddy.
No.
The turkey's to be divided according to where the people come from.
Oh, good, good.
Captain Houston, where are you from?
I'm from the north.
The north? You get the neck. Mr. Hull?
I'm a westerner.
All right, sir, so you get the west wing. I'm from the east, so I'll take the east wing. Connie, where are you from?
I'm from the south, and I don't like turkey.
Kill him all pale face.
Oh! Connie, you insulted him. He'll have us all scalped.
Yes, he's mad at Connie.
No, he ain't.
Snooks, did you have anything to do with this?
Uh-huh.
What did you do?
I gave the Blackfoot the hot foot.
What a hi, Thanksgiving.
Nine weeks ago, when Meredith Willson began the present concert hall series, he hoped that American composers were capable of writing the kind of beautiful music that men of all nations would remember and love always. Now Meredith believes more than ever that they can. The music of four fine American composers, all of them men, has been acclaimed with great enthusiasm in the past 4 weeks. Tonight's composer is a woman, the celebrated Dana Suisse, whose American Nocturne, written especially for this series, will now be given its world premiere. All right, Meredith, Miss Dana Suisse's American Nocturne.
Thank you.
beautiful, Meredith. All of us here at the concert hall join in sending our compliments to Miss Dana Suisse for her American Nocturne. Next week, Meredith will introduce the sixth of our new American compositions, A Song Without Words by Vernon Duke. And now Meredith Wilson has another commission to make for the concert hall series, an American Barcarolle. Whom have you selected to write it, Meredith?
Everyone knows him, Eddie. Among many other things, he's famous for this beautiful composition. Of course, it's Harry Warren, one of our best-loved and finest popular composers. I hereby commission you, Harry Warren, to write an American Barcarolle to be introduced on Good News soon. Good luck to you, Harry, and we all know you'll do a fine job.
I don't like to be too optimistic, ladies and gentlemen, but next week looks like a very fine program. In addition to Fanny Bryce, his baby Snooks, and her daddy, Henley Stafford, Connie Boswell, Meredith Wilson, and his orchestra, we have as our special guest one of my favorite comedians, Lou Holtz. And, of course, I'll be tagging along, too. So this is Edward Arnold, hoping to see you again next week, and bidding you now good night.
This is Warren Hull reminding you that the easy-to-follow directions for making Maxwell House coffee are printed right on the can. By following them, you're sure to get the full flavor and goodness of Maxwell House in the most economical way. And now, good night and good luck from the makers of Maxwell House, the coffee that's now, more than ever, good to the last drop.
This is the National Broadcasting Company.